Hey, welcome back to the Personality Hacker Podcast. My name is Joel Mark Witt.
And I'm Antonia Dodge.
You know, we get a lot of email, a lot of messages, a lot of comments and feedback and questions about personality types and romance. This is the season of romance. We're going to talk about it in the next few podcasts. And the question we often get is, okay, I'm this type. And somebody will give us their type. And they'll say, okay, what's my perfect match? What's my perfect romantic match for my type? Go. And it's like, well, type is one aspect of compatibility and romance and getting together with somebody in a romantic way. There's all sorts of things that I think are way more important, which is shared values and the way you see the world and your cultural upbringing. And a lot of factors go into this. Type is one thing you can look at, but to base who you're going to be attracted to or who you're going to get into a relationship with, or who you're going to date, I think is nuts if you look at it just through the lens of type. So I think that's somewhat of a limited perspective to say I'm this type, who am I most compatible with? That's our big disclaimer.
Yeah.
Because we want to be, we're going to give some principles though on this podcast based on some things you might want to look at when you're looking at a partner in a romantic relationship.
Yeah, it's almost that same principle as when somebody wants to hire somebody in a company based entirely on their personality type or their Myers-Briggs type.
Yeah.
That's almost always a terrible idea. You want to find the best candidate, the most qualified candidate for the position. But once you discover what personality type the person that is working for you is, now you can relate to them a lot better. And every once in a while, type is important in matching people to the right position. But most of the time, it's better to know after the hire than necessarily before the hire, as a general rule. And it works very similarly with romance. You fall in love with who you fall in love with. And if you have shared values and interests and everything else is compatible, then it's more important to know the type after you fall in love with somebody than necessarily like vet each potential person based on a personality type.
Yeah, it's kind of like it's a better tool for helping deal with conflict and conflict resolution than maybe attraction. I mean, you can use it to somewhat attraction. I mean, I know that there's going to be some types that I'm more attracted to than others. And same thing with you. I think everybody has that. We have like energy attractors that come. And so there's a proclivity to certain types being attractive to us. But sometimes you're surprised. Sometimes you're attracted to who you're attracted to. And you know, attraction's not a choice. You can't really help that. However, when you get into the conflict realm and there's issues that pop up, it can give you a good tool set to say, okay, I'm dating this person. Can we get past some of this conflict? Is this going to be something we'll never see eye to eye based on our personalities? Or is this something based on our personalities we could get to some type of a resolution? We could start seeing some compromise here. And now we have this tool in front of us that we can use as a framework. And I think that, like you said, after the fact, it's so much more of a powerful way to come at it. And having said that, I think we can talk a little bit about these aspects in the next few podcasts. In this podcast, though, we want to tackle the differences in dichotomies. So dichotomies, it's that four-letter code in the Myers-Briggs system. You know, I'm an ENFP, for example. So my dichotomies are extrovert, intuitive, feeler, perceiver. That's my dichotomy structure of how my type plays out. So we're going to talk about just the dichotomies. Then in a future podcast, we'll talk about the wiring of your mind, the mental processes that are technically called cognitive functions. And we'll talk about the differences and compatibilities between those. And then we can talk about maybe some systems thinking and also the Graves models that applies to romance and relationships. So,
yeah. Well, and when we talk about cognitive functions in the next podcast, I just want to make it clear that we're not going to do it like a side-by-side comparison because there's just too many possible combinations. We will talk about general principles, though, once you know what your cognitive function stack is and your spouse's or mate's cognitive function stack, or what we call the CAR model. In this podcast, we'll talk about the dichotomies, like Joel mentioned. Now, a dichotomy means a pairing of opposites. And so, as Joel mentioned, his dichotomies are ENFP, but the dichotomies themselves are extrovert-introvert, intuitive-sensor, feeler-thinker, judger-perceiver. And then, of course, those dichotomies in various, you know, mixes and matches make 16 different personality types. Now, what we're going to do is we're going to talk about each of the four dichotomies. What if you are paired with somebody who has the opposite dichotomy of you? What if you're paired with somebody who has the same dichotomy as you? So we'll start with like extroverts and introverts together, and then two extroverts together and two introverts together. And then we'll move on to sensing, intuition, and so on. But what's interesting about looking at people who have these pairings of opposites is that there's a lot that we can offer each other when we have opposite pairings. But there's a lot that we can offer each other when we have the same as well. Like Joel and I have a lot of our dichotomies are the same. I'm an ENTP, he's an ENFP. And this might be the most compatible relationship I've ever had.
Only one letter's off, the T and the F.
Exactly. And so there's a lot to be said for that piece. But then also, like, on a daily basis, we look at each other and go, oh, we've really doubled up on our blind spots, haven't we? And that's sometimes not that great. So there's things that, there are rewards and gifts in having the same as you, and then there's some blind spots and pitfalls there. And there are rewards and gifts in having the opposite and some pitfalls there as well. And that's what we'd like to discuss.
Okay, so we look at the first set of dichotomies, introversion versus extroversion. And what happens if somebody in relationship is an extrovert and the other person is an introvert? Obviously, this is a difference of how they're going to show up to the world. You know, and the classic definition, the extrovert's wanting to go out and meet people and hang out and go out and do fun things all the time. And the introvert wants to just stay home and read a book every night or watch a movie quietly on the couch. And those are very, I guess, over-stereotyped versions of these. But I think this is one of the most basic conflict or differences that we all can see. Even if you aren't familiar with personality types, most people understand this idea of introvert versus extrovert. And I think the biggest thing in this dynamic, when you have somebody that is an introvert, somebody's an extrovert, is just having the needs of those, the other person on your radar. That if you are the extrovert in the relationship, you're looking at the relationship and going, okay, I know that my partner needs some alone time. I know they need some downtime. And I know that especially if I take them out partying tonight, they're probably going to be out of commission tomorrow. This is, you know, this is pretty straightforward. This is stuff that I think you're getting, right? If you're listening. And then the introvert needs to know that there is a need for the extrovert to not only go and do things in the outside world and maybe connect with people and be more out there, but also that the introvert would join them on those, some of those adventures. Not all the time, but definitely get out of their shell and come over and be a part of some of those experiences, because that's very important to the extrovert to feel like they're a part of it. Now, I would say a lot of movies, the relationships in movies often have this dynamic at play. If you want to see like basic dynamics, I think movies point to this in a pretty profound way over and over and over again. So this is something that I think most people have a conscious awareness of, generally speaking.
Yeah, the first movie that comes to mind that really displays this is the movie Eternal Sunshine of the Spotless Mind.
Yeah.
Which, if you haven't seen it, go see it. It's pretty good.
I like the main character's name.
Jim Carrey plays a character named Joel, and Kate Winslet plays a character named Clementine. And I don't usually like to tell what my type guesses are on a lot of stuff because I don't like to get into like type arguments, but I passively profiled them regardless of whether or not I'm accurate. Clementine as an ENFP and Joel as an INFP. So they're very similar. I mean, all the rest of the dichotomies are the same except for the first. And as an extrovert, Clementine feels very stuck in the relationship because Joel seems to want to, after the initial excitement of the relationship wears, then she wants to go have more excitement. Now, regardless of whether or not she's a very healthy version of her type, there's a sense of staying home all the time just with your mate is not sufficient for her. She's getting some like sensory deprivation and she needs to go fill that need. Whereas Joel has an easier time of just wanting to be connected to Clementine. And so he tries to be quirky in order to, you know, get her attention, but that's not enough because she needs different stimulus. And so what's interesting about this, and we talk about introversion, extroversion a little different than other people do. We talk about it mostly as energy management and which world is the real world to you. But if you're an extrovert in a relationship with an introvert, it's very important to understand that if there's a reluctance to go out with you all the time and, you know, have, we call them adventures, but it could just be like going and seeing a movie or whatever, but just being out.
Yeah.
If there's a reluctance, it means that there's a need going unmet most of the time. It means that they need to have, like, their energy is being sapped. Now, there are cases when introverts get so used to not having to go out that they won't push themselves out of their comfort zone. And that's why being in a relationship with an extrovert is usually very healthy for an introvert, because the extrovert will push them out of their comfort zone and force them to go into a world that maybe feels really like off.
Or even better, coax them out of their comfort zone.
Right. Yeah. Force is a bad word, isn't it? Coax them, encourage them, seduce them out into the world. And then if it's being done in the most healthy way, and you know, we mentioned cognitive functions, they'll go to their co-pilot or auxiliary cognitive function, and then they'll be able to grow in health using that extroverted process as an introvert. But there are some introverts that just kind of put their foot down and go, nope, I'm not leaving the house. But that's not that common. That's a kind of a sign of a lack of health. Most introverts want to have a balance. It's just if they have a really taxing job situation or if they have a really taxing like family situation, that's going to pull their energy and they're going to need more time for recuperation. And if an extrovert understands that, they can hold space for that situation. On the opposite side, if you're an introvert in a relationship with an extrovert, if they feel like they're abandoning you a lot, it's not abandonment. It's a need to go get that extra stimuli to feed that driver process of theirs that is extroverted. And I don't think it's very, I've seen a lot of very healthy relationships where they're introverts like, yeah, go. I mean, if you want to go, that's fine. That's not that big of a deal. And there's not a lot of jealousy there. But sometimes there is, right? The extrovert is out doing fun stuff and the introvert's like, you know, they didn't want to go until the extrovert left the house and then all of a sudden they want to go, right? There's the kind of that weird push-pull relationship introverts have.
Sure.
And so what can happen there is if the introvert gives the extrovert space to go have those moments, those adventures, if you want to call them adventures, but usually it's just going and getting some stimuli, then you usually have a pretty decent relationship. But again, one of the advantages to being in a relationship with an introvert, if you're an extrovert, is that the introvert will encourage you to slow down and maybe be a little more patient or maybe have some quieter times that will allow you to get into your co-pilot or auxiliary process, or at least give you a space to do that, encourage you to be there. So it can be a relationship where once you've figured out what the unique needs of your spouse or mate are, then it can be a major opportunity for growth.
Yeah.
And that polarization can be quite attractive, like difference, that sort of mysticism of the other can be quite attractive. It's just making sure that you honor both needs and then do what you can to meet the other person halfway.
Two things I want to say. I think that when conflict comes up between an introvert and an extrovert in relationship, the natural proclivity for us humans is to go into our sandbox, to retreat into the place that we know well. So when conflict arises, it's very easy for the extrovert to potentially be like, okay, that's it. I'm just going to go out and get my needs met extroversion-wise, or the introvert to close in on themselves. And both of them, whatever their version of this is put their foot down, and then it causes more conflict because they're retreating into or adventuring out into what is comfortable for them. And I think that is something to watch for. If that's your relationship, watch for that dynamic that emerges when conflict arises, and call it and try to nip that in the bud before it becomes a problem, before it's, oh man, she's on the couch every night. She will never come out with me. And it's almost like she's retreating into her little, or he or whoever is retreating their little, like, I'm not going to get off here and go, you know, get off on the couch and go do something with you because there's conflict. And I'm using this as a way to take control of the situation. So I think that's one thing to watch out for. The other thing I think that I would mention to introverts, particularly if you are in a relationship with an extrovert, oftentimes because the extrovert, it will be out there and meeting people and bombastic. Oftentimes what can happen is the extrovert is carrying a lot of the social load sometimes. So like if you're in a social situation, oftentimes the extrovert in the situation will do most of the talking and help facilitate the social engagement. And oftentimes you as an introvert will totally rest into that. You love it because you're like, okay, I don't have to do any of the talking or very little talking. I can rest into my partner who can help facilitate the interactions here at this dinner party or this movie or whatever we're doing together. However, I've seen, like in the coaching I've done with certain introverts, I've seen a resentment start to build over this. Man, the person I'm in relationship with is getting all the attention. They're getting all the accolades. Everybody's talking to them. And I feel like a third wheel almost. Them and all the fun people they're talking to. And here I feel like usually I like it. Usually I'm okay with it. But today I'm feeling really bad about myself. I feel like they're getting everything and I'm getting nothing. And I wish I was more extroverted. I wish they didn't take everything. And it could cause some conflict in your relationship. If you start to feel insecure as an introvert, you could start thinking that they're doing this to you and they're purposely hurting you by being them, their natural self. So I think that's one way that conflict can arise in this dynamic with an introvert who is usually okay with it, but then starts to build resentment that the extrovert is the one getting all the limelight and attention all the time. And I think the strategy is to, again, we tell you all the time to grow your co-pilot. So if you're an introvert, growing your co-pilot will help you become more extroverted, and it'll give you a framework for that and something that's healthy for you to do. So it's growing it in a deliberate way. And realize that most times you probably need to reconnect with your partner to realize they're not doing this to you. This is a dynamic that has emerged just naturally, and they just have been used to taking the lead. They can't necessarily read that this is starting to build resentment for you. So you've got to be forthcoming with that. You got to notice this in yourself and say, you know what, partner of mine, I kind of feel like this resentment's building for me and it might be causing some problems down the road. And I don't know exactly what to do with it, but you guys could start that conversation and start dealing with those kind of things.
Yeah. Well, and you can, I think the other piece is when you find resentment building because your spouse has something that you don't have, and both, like, no matter what personality type you have, you're going to have access to something that is a natural talent of yours that your spouse, unless they're the exact same personality type, probably doesn't have access to. One of the best things is to remember that's why you're attracted to them in the first place. And the services that are brought to the table based on that other, that, and I think not feeling seen is sometimes an issue for some introverts, especially if they're very introverted. And again, one of the best ways to not feel unseen is to get to exercise that co-pilot process of yours, which is extroverted, and then allow yourself to not matching the extrovert. Like, I think I've seen sometimes mates will try to mirror exactly the strategy of the extroverted spouse, and that's not working out for them and doesn't feel right because it's not authentic to the introvert to just mirror the behavior of their extroverted spouse.
Yeah.
And what would feel authentic is to develop greater, you know, capacity in your extroverted process. And so that will feel authentic to you. And you do have natural talent there. It's just a matter of building the skill as well as having the talent.
I think this comes from because extroverted activities are rewarded so much in society, that's why it tends to skew this direction. It's very rare that an extrovert's like, man, I wish I was more introverted. It's more the opposite. And it's because the extrovert's rewarded by society and in general.
Yeah. Well, however, on the opposite side of the coin, one of the things that can come up in this relationship is that introverts have very full inner worlds. Like, they're very textured and there's a lot going on inside of them. And just like with everyone, like, there are some aspects of my inner terrain that nobody's going to access. But I think introverts are very connected to just how much of their inner terrain is just for them, is just for themselves. And I have seen in relationships between introverts and extroverts that it feels like there's a part of the introverted mate that the extrovert just feels is inaccessible. Like, there's this fleshed out inner terrain that they can never quite access. And it kind of feels like, maybe to an extrovert, and lots of extroverts, not all of them, but I think extroverts have a tendency to race towards intimacy a little faster than introverts do, unless the extrovert's been burned or they have something going on with them. If they're relatively healthy and feel that the universe is a friendly place and, you know, like are generally up people, they oftentimes have no problem connecting with others, and that's a joy for them. And so when the introvert withholds connectivity and might feel more vulnerable being in that space, an extrovert could feel like something's wrong. Like, what's wrong? Why won't you connect with me? Like, I really want to be doing stuff with you. I want to be, you know, I really want to be as bonded as possible. And for the introvert, there's just going to be a space inside them that is just for them, like 100% just for them. And I think there are some introverts who have done some intimacy training and intimacy work, which they allow themselves to get as intimate as humanly possible with another person. And there will still be a part of them that is just for them. So if you are an extrovert in a relationship with an introvert and it feels like there's a world inside of there that you're not able to access, there's nothing wrong. It's not being withheld from you.
Yeah.
It's not something that they're trying, like, it's not a message they're giving. It's just, nobody will ever be in that terrain inside of them, just like nobody's ever going to be inside somebody else's experience. So it's not a sign that anything is wrong or unhealthy or bad. It just means that there's a part that is truly inaccessible to anybody other than that introvert. And yeah. they probably are giving you a lot more entrance than just about anybody else. If you're in a healthy, robust relationship, you are getting greater access than anybody else probably ever has before. And they're mapping their inner terrain to include you. So you're a part of that inner world as far as they're concerned. There just might be some spots that are only for them and that they need to go visit sometimes and you're not invited. And that's okay. That's not unhealthy.
Yeah, it's not being done to you. I think we want to briefly mention, you know, if you're two extroverts in relationship also, or two introverts in relationship, and there's a principle here that anytime you have two of the same, you're doubling up on your strengths, but also on some of your challenges or weaknesses. So I think keep that principle in mind, and we'll highlight some of the things that might look like as we go through this. But two extroverts, I think it could be a great relationship. It can be very fun. It can be outgoing, a lot of activity happening. And I think the doubling up there on maybe the negative or the challenging side is, I think we struggle with this. We don't have nearly as much alone time or downtime to just reflect and think that we probably need in life. Because we're always like, oh, I want to go do this thing. Oh, I want to go do it too. And we jump in the car together and go do that thing. And so we double up on the activity. And then I think sometimes we end up getting a little, not shell-shocked, but burned out from not getting enough alone time and introvert time because we're so excited to spend fun activities and adventures together. And even if they're little adventures like going to see a movie, that doubling up, I think, can cause that challenge of getting burned out quickly.
I had been in sort of a recovery time period from the last year and some things that had been sort of emotionally taxing for me and some things I had been figuring out, and I hadn't quite recovered. So you and I and Piper went on a week vacation to Florida that just sit by the pool, do nothing, chill out, not have anything, like, you know, no stresses, etc. And when I came back, I was relatively refreshed, but I still found myself struggling a little bit. And then just out of the blue, you had to go out of town for a couple of days. And it also just happened that your mom, Grandma, wanted Piper for a couple days. So for the first time in probably 5 years, like since Piper was born at least, I was all by myself in the house for two full days. And I can't even tell you how cathartic that experience was.
Yeah.
It was insane. Like by the time you came back, like you came in and I'm like working like crazy and I've got all this energy for work and all this clarity and like... And it was because I had two full days. And like when you left and when Piper left, I went, I can do anything I want. I can go play video games. I can go surf the internet. I can watch a movie. I can work.
I don't have to get anybody's needs met or clean up or anything.
Nothing. I can just let everything go to hell and just be here. And I'm like, this is the most amazing thing ever. So what I did is I ended up sitting on the couch, not bathing at all, stewing in my own juices, eating way too much cheese and crackers and probably a little too much wine. And I was like, I can play video games, but I didn't. And I was like, I can watch a movie. And I watched one movie, I think. But for the most part, I just sort of like sat there and did nothing. And it was amazing. And then the second day, I'm like, man, I really need to get back to work. So when you got back, I was like, I couldn't have prescribed myself this before it happened because I didn't know how badly I needed it. And I was like, you need it, Joel. We got to get you one of these 2 days. Like, we got to get you one. But since you got back, we haven't left each other's side. Like, we literally have been, you know, we're
doing stuff, yeah, together a lot.
Because we just love spending time around each other all the time. So as extroverts, the thing that we need to remember is to fold in some true, authentic alone time from each other.
Yeah, and I think on the other side, if there's two introverts, that can be very compatible too. You are cool with staying at home, and one of you maybe is on the computer playing a video game or surfing the web while the other one's reading in the other room. And it's like, hey, honey, you want some tea? And, you know, you get some tea for them, and then they give them tea, and then you're back to your old, you know, your old activities there. And that, I think the challenge there is that can be a great benefit because you're both doing the thing you love to do. However, I think the challenge that can arise from it is you get in a rut, you get in a routine, and you forget to go do anything outside of that dynamic. So you can reinforce each other's staying at home. Oh, do you want to go out tonight? Not really. I mean, it's like 10 degrees colder than I'm used to or whatever. I just don't feel like it. And it's easy to find excuses because the other person's like, yeah, I don't really want to either. Let's just stay at home and read books or get on the internet or watch a movie together on the couch or whatever. Yeah. So I think, and I don't think there's anything wrong with any of that. But again, just like if Antonio and I never get alone time and we're just always extroverting constantly together, we're going to burn out. I think you can get stuck there. I think your energies can start to get more dense and you start to lose a little bit of the zest for life if you just reinforce constant introversion.
Yeah.
So I think that's also unhealthy to some degree. So I think these are things to watch out for. Not saying they're always going to happen. I think these are the tendencies potentially if you're with somebody of the same dichotomy.
Yeah. Make sure that you're pushing each other out of comfort zones. Not pushing, but like there's something to be said for being out of your comfort zone on a pretty regular basis.
Yeah.
So not so much that you're hurting yourself, but make sure that's you got your finger on the pulse of that. So the next pairing of opposites is the sensor intuition dichotomy. And when you have a person who's a sensor and a person who's an intuitive in the relationship, this is one that can get a little dicey, a little tricky.
Challenging for sure.
Yeah, definitely. And I think one of the reasons why is so there are certain needs that both sensors and intuitives have that are quite different from each other. And in a relationship where they're together, there's a lot to be said for what the other side teaches you. There's a lot of lessons to be learned, and a lot of like the other person is covering most of your blind spots, which is fantastic. And sometimes it becomes a situation where you don't really appreciate how much the other person is handling in your behalf, because it's easy to devalue the other side's concerns and needs. It's really easy to feel bound by them as opposed to liberated by how much they're doing in your behalf.
Now, remember, this is how you look at the world. This is how you show up and perceive your world, you know, through your senses, directly what's verifiable, confirmable, or more speculative, the intuitive side, which is going to be about what's behind the curtain, what if questions, things of this nature. So you can already see that if you're seeing different things in the world, that could have conflict in it or some potentials to just not be on the same page because you're not seeing the same thing, basically. But I think you're right. I think you are covering, almost not knowing it, covering each other's blind spots in a lot of ways because it's something that is on your radar. It's so profound how you see the world. Like, it's so much a part of your experience. You cannot see the world that way. And so the other person doesn't see the world that way. They're unaware of how you're seeing the world and what you're taking care of for them.
Yeah. And I think some of the biggest challenges you might have is, first, if you are an intuitive in a relationship with an intuitive and a sensor, an intuitive needs intuitive conversation. It's one of the things that fuels their spirit. And so if they don't get that on a fairly regular basis, there's going to feel like something's missing, even if they can't quite put their finger on it. So if they connect with another person who's intuitive, maybe a family member or a friend, sometimes it feels like the sensor's being left out of something that might even, like, their instincts tell them this is something that's important. Now, not all the time. The sensor may be like, yeah, they just go talk about whatever they're talking about. That's fine. And the sensor doesn't have any issue with it whatsoever. But sometimes the sensor can feel a little left out in the conversation because they don't really understand why that's important. On the other side of the coin, intuitives have a tendency to be a bit more risk-taking. Now, not always. Like, some sensors, like sensor perceivers, can be risk-takers in certain ways. But for the most part, sensors like things that are steady, right? They like a certain level of predictability in their life, or a sense of groundedness, rather. And maybe not predictability, but groundedness. And that may or may not be something that's important to the intuitive. So the intuitive might be constantly pushing the sensor out of a feeling of groundedness. They might inadvertently be pushing them in a sense of instability. Yeah. Because the intuitive doesn't take the hit when that happens.
Especially mimetically risky stuff. Like, mostly it's mimetic risk of like new ideas, new thoughts, new ways of seeing something. A sensor might be open to it, but that it depends on what it is. It can be very threatening or destabilizing for somebody with sensation.
Or the memory process. I would say that it can even be like physically, though. Like, it can be like the intuitive might be opportunity chasing. They might be trying to go, they might be trying to start a business and be entrepreneurial. And the sensor's like, well, have we counted like what this will mean? Like, have we made sure that we're in a financial situation so that if you quit your job and you go off to be an entrepreneur, that we're going to be okay? And the intuitive's like, I don't want to have to think about that. I just feel this really, like, I just know that this is the thing I should be doing. So I'm just going to go. And the sensor's like, yeah, but we have a couple kids here. So what happens if you just go like become an entrepreneur and then it doesn't pan out? And then what do we do? I'm part of this risk taking. And the intuitive might feel kind of stifled by that and like, oh, it's bringing me down. And it this is a matter of the two sides needing to understand the other, the profound foundational needs of the other. It is not inappropriate for a sensor to want to have a feeling of groundedness. That's not wrong. They're not intending to pull you down. It's not an intent to like dash your dreams. If they're like, hey, have we counted some of the cost? Like, let's make sure that this is going to be okay. That there is so much importance there to making sure that somebody's taking that into consideration. By the same token, the intuitive is not trying to destroy your life, like the sensor's life or the life of the family. There is a sense of needing to be able to do things in a different way, a way that is not the norm. And like you said, sometimes the risks feel mimetic. That includes not living the template, not just working your way up in an office or how like whatever is the counter, what would feel like a counter to common sense or the thing that is unfamiliar is always going to be the most attractive to the intuitive. And that's not inappropriate of them to want. In fact, that's their nature. So being able to understand that there's no like desire to harm the other person. There's no sense of like neither one is doing something inappropriate. Both of them are doing things that are fully in alignment with who they are. They're both being authentic.
I think for sensors, what I would say is if the intuitive in your life that you're in relationship with, they say, man, I don't want to, you know, you have this life that you live and it looks like they're unsatisfied with the life to you that seems reasonable. Everyone around you is living this life. It feels happy and healthy and normal, and most people live this life, and the intuitive saying, well, I want more. I want something more. What could often happen is a sensor is you could say, oh, that's because I'm not enough, or they don't like me as a person. That's a rejection or a commentary on who I am. And I think I would guard against feeling that way. If an intuitive says that to you, if you're in a relationship with an intuitive and they're like, I want more out of life. I want to do some bigger things. That's not directly, I mean, if everybody's healthy and you're in a good relationship, I don't believe that's directed at you as a person. I believe that's directed at the situation they're in, and they would like to maybe express themselves in different ways. And if you take it personal, that could be a source of conflict in your relationship because it may not be about you. It might be about them and expanding their horizons and what they want to do. And you don't necessarily have to go along with it, but please try not to take that personal as an attack or an affront on you as a person. It's probably just circumstantial. And they're eager to express themselves in ways they haven't been able to up till now.
Yeah. By the same token, it's kind of easy for intuitive spouses to take their sensor spouses for granted.
Absolutely.
Because they don't necessarily value all of the things that are happening or that the sensor is providing until it stops being provided for. As in, like, I remember an INTJ telling me that she was married to an ISTJ. And she's like, I can't even count the different ways that he takes care of me. Like he makes sure that I'm comfortable when I'm sick, and he makes sure to take care, you know, he takes care of all this stuff for me. And she's like, he just makes sure that life continues on in such, she's like, I forget about it. It's this thing that I only remember when he gets sick and it all stops.
The bills get paid, the car oil gets changed,
yeah.
Like stuff happens around the house or whatever.
Right, and you might be married to a sensor who is not necessarily taking care of things in that specific way, but they're probably taking care of some stuff that you're not seeing. And so they might be bringing more art and beauty into your life, and you just have this beautifully visual experience by being inside the house because they're so, you know, wonderfully aesthetically artistic. Or they might be bringing more fun into your life. They're just exciting and they're up for anything. And there's lots of different flavors of sensors, just like there's lots of different flavors of intuitives. But they're probably handling something that you don't bring to the table, which is why you were attracted to them in the first place. So just like it can be easy for a sensor to feel maybe marginalized by an intuitive, it can be easy for an intuitive to take a sensor for granted. And it's really important to, if you're in one of these relationships, to make sure that you're, all the reasons you were initially attracted, all the things that they're doing for you in your life, even if it's easy to undervalue those, both sides of the coin, it can be easy to undervalue what the other one brings. If it's destabilizing, that doesn't feel like it's bringing something positive. It feels like it's bringing something negative. But the reality is that is a person with extraordinary imagination that wants to bring that imagination to the outer world. And we need innovation. And for the other side, as I mentioned, sensors can bring an extraordinarily grounded feeling that the intuitive needs in order to have a platform. Like, that's one of the things that allows intuitives to be able to be innovative, is that we don't have a completely anarchistic, chaotic world, in large part because of sensors. So really appreciating what the other brings to the relationship is the best way to keep that relationship working.
And we are obviously oversimplifying intuitives and sensors for this discussion. Obviously, sensors are imaginative and have a lot of abstract thought. It's not like they can't think that way. And obviously, intuitives can be grounded and get things accomplished in the real world in a tangible way. We're talking about them in silos and isolation to help understand the dynamics, not to say this is a one-dimensional person. So just understand that. And you, I think you listening are intelligent enough to realize that that's what we're intending. We're not saying this is a broad brush of how intuitives and sensors show up to the world.
Yeah. Or that it is a broad brush, but it's not necessarily going to apply to every situation.
Yeah. So what if we have two intuitives together, right? And now again, the principle of doubling up on your strengths and doubling up on your challenges comes to fruition, comes to the forefront. Two intuitives, obviously, they're now seeing the world in a very similar way. Now, one might have a different style of intuition, but both are looking for the what if questions, the behind the curtain thinking, abstract conversation. And so this can be a very joyful and pleasurable experience, a very joyful and pleasurable relationship. However, if you're in the abstract world all the time, and if you're thinking about high-minded ideas, I think you and I struggle with this, Antonio, often, is you let the tangible details of your life sometimes slide, or worse, you have no awareness of them. Like, you just don't even realize you're letting certain things go because the cost of specialization is there. Both of you are specializing on the abstract conversation, abstract thought, all this other thing. And now you've let maybe your whatever tangible stuff in your life go. Yeah. So I think that's the challenge that can arise from that. And again, that could maybe cause conflict because it's like, well, that's your responsibility. No, that's your responsibility to take care of those things or whatever. And that can cause some disagreements or some conflict in relationship.
Yeah, oftentimes when there are truly unpleasant tasks, it's easy for two intuitives to play hot potato with that task. It's like, oh, I hate doing that. And the other person's like, I hate doing that too. So then who is the person who gets stuck with it? And I think what you and I have done is we have certain domestic things that we didn't really even talk about them. We just sort of allocated some of the extraordinarily unpleasant tasks to you, and then I get a batch of the extraordinarily unpleasant tasks. And they happen they just happen behind the scenes. Like, I don't even have to think about it. Like, taxes is something that you handle because my head will explode if I even have to think about it. So I don't think about it. Like, taxes just magically get done. And then on my side, or in behalf of you, like, the house is almost always clean, most of the time. I would say most of the time. And laundry just magically happens around you.
It does.
Like, you don't have to think about laundry. Laundry just magically happens.
I think I've done laundry like twice in the last 5 years of marriage or something like that.
Right, exactly. So, and we didn't really talk about it. I think it's because, I mean, for those of you that are Myers-Briggs geeks, I think it's because Joel, as an ENFP, is TE tertiary or effectiveness 10-year-old. So taxes is something he kind of can handle. And I'm FE tertiary or harmony 10-year-old. So, like, domestic things are something I can kind of handle. And so we both know that we're not going to handle them beautifully. And we cut each other some slack. It's like, if the taxes are not done meticulously, I'm going to be okay with that. And if
my pants gets ruined in the wash, I'm okay.
Yeah, you're gonna be like, okay, it's okay. It's gonna be okay. So, and I think that's what we've done, is we just both know that we're taking one for the team in a different way. And every once in a while, we'll have that conversation where it's like, you don't appreciate me. And then the other person will be like, you don't appreciate me. And then we go, wait, no, we totally appreciate the other person, because remember how much the other person does.
Yeah. I think when sensors are paired together, I quite honestly don't have a lot of, like, on the top of my mind, natural conflict that arises, because obviously 75% of the population is sensor and 25% is intuitive. So the likelihood of sensors getting in relationship with each other is not out of the norm, in that there's no unique problems there. They're just normal relationship problems that arise. Now, the one thing that could happen is when those relationship challenges arise, depending on the type of sensor in the relationship, sometimes the the ability to perspective shift and the other person's perspective can be challenging just because that's not in their wheelhouse. To shift the mindset of someone else, you can do that. I mean, anybody can do that. But sometimes that's the realm of, for example, introverted intuition. And a lot of sensors either don't have that in their cognitive function stack or CAR, or it's an inferior or tertiary process. It's 10-year-old or 3-year-old process. And so it's something that it's more of a childlike quality for a lot of sensors. So shifting perspective can sometimes be a challenge. But I don't think there's anything inherently unique, I would say, for two sensors in relationship that I can think of off the top of my head, except just normal relationship challenges.
I can think of one.
Can you think of one?
If they both rest into each other's groundedness, they may not encourage each other to live life to the most adventurous full.
So they can end up in a, like we talked about with Jason Gaddis on the podcast, a safe relationship.
Yeah.
Where they just keep seeking comfort and safety.
Yeah, exactly. Or I mean, there's that whole concept of like at the end of your life, or that bucket list concept. Like at the end of your life, it's more of what you didn't do that you regret than what you actually do. And I think that if you have two sensors that don't encourage each other to get out of your comfort zone and take a lot of, you know, like fun risks, then there might be a sense of like a little bit of disappointment for what you didn't do. Like, I always wanted to go to Europe, but I didn't. Whereas I think in an intuitive sensor relationship, the intuitive is more likely to encourage the sensor to push their boundaries. And while the sensor brings that groundedness, that's one of the things that the intuitive can bring to, not always, but can bring to the relationship, is this sense of like, yeah, let's go do the things that most people don't do. Let's go travel to, you know, some country nobody's ever heard of, and let's go do that. And I think that in a sensor to sensor relationship, there's probably going to be a lot less of that. And for the two sensors, that might be perfectly fine.
But
they
as far
have
as
no problem.
But as far as conflict arising, I mean, that's something that'll be over time at the end of your life, maybe, or later down the road. You're like, wow, we're really in a rut and comfortable. But I mean, I can't think of anything conflict wise because they're both sensors in a relationship.
Yeah, that's the template.
Except maybe the difficulty in shifting perspective sometimes, depending on the person.
Yeah. And maybe you are two sensors. You and your spouse are both sensors, and maybe you have more insight into this than we would, actually.
Yeah.
So if you are a sensor in a relationship with another sensor and you've got some insight into, you know, some of the things that would be particular or peculiar to that, we would love to hear it. But I think, like you said, a comfortable relationship, one that doesn't really push the boundaries as much once that feeling of groundedness is experienced, maybe not doing as many like big, wild, crazy things that might be regretted later. But I think you're right. I think that's kind of the template relationship. And so a lot of it will be like relationship, like standard basic relationship problems.
So let's talk about the third dichotomy, thinker versus feeler, T versus F. And this is actually the only letter in our dichotomies that is mismatched. We're both extrovert, intuitive perceivers, but you're a thinker, Antonia, and I'm a feeler. So this is the one that we have off from each other. So that's good as a way to talk about it. This is a direct experience. We're not doubling up on our strengths and weaknesses, challenges. So when you have people that are in a relationship and one is a thinker and one is a feeler, obviously the thinking and feeling process is how we decide upon the information that we take in from the world. That's how we evaluate how we're going to move through and make decisions on moving forward. And all decision-making processes are should-based processes. So what should be happening in the world, all of us are wired to have our opinions and thoughts about how the world should be. And this process here, whether it's thinking or feeling, is where that comes from. This is how you make decisions moving forward on that. So all of a sudden, this is a very clear, I think it's very clear if you're listening and you're intelligent, you probably pattern recognize this going forward. You can see the conflict arise here if you have a thinker and a feeler who are using different criteria about what should be happening in the world. The feeler is much more interested in the human component. Obviously, they take in metrics and data. All feelers can think, right? They're not just feeling through it, but they're putting emphasis on the human connection or the interpersonal experience they're having. It's a very subjective, emotional, people-centric view of making decisions in the world. And then on the other side, thinkers obviously take people into account and have feelings of their own. They're not just thought, but they are looking at all the impersonal criteria to move forward. They're looking at the data set. They're looking at the resource available, managing all of that. and people can be added into the data set or resource, but they're one node in the system. It's more centric around the data or the thought process, not the people-centric process. So you can already see the conflict between thinkers and feelers emerge when one is putting more emphasis on one thing and one is putting more emphasis on the other.
Yeah. I think most relationship struggles are stereotypes based on a thinker male and a feeler female in a relationship with each other.
Like every stand-up comedian on the planet.
Yeah.
This is the trope.
Well, and women are from Venus and men are from Mars. Like that kind of, that sense that all men want to be alone in their man cave and every woman wants to connect. And there is some truth to the stereotypes. Stereotypes, you know, they exist for a reason, and it's because they're mirroring how a chunk of the population is legitimately engaging with each other. So somebody reads a book like Women Are from Mars, Men Are from Venus. I mean, the opposite. Women are from Venus, men are from Mars. Or I think it's actually Men Are from Mars, Women Are from Venus.
Now so, you've got me totally confused. Go Google it.
John Gray, right? That's the dude who wrote it. Okay. Yeah. So a person can read that and just be like, oh my gosh, he had it so dead on right. Like he's just, is he reading my journal? And then other people read it, people like us, where I'm the thinker and you're the feeler. And we're like, yeah, maybe not so much. Like that's not really mirroring our experience. And legitimately, there's a reason for those stereotypes, too, because like 75% of women are feelers and something like 65% of men are thinkers. So it's very common for that relationship to come up. But the most common relationship is, I mean, another common relationship is feeler to feeler, because there's slightly more feelers in the world than thinkers. And then I think the least common is probably a thinker to thinker relationship. And different things come with all of this, just like with all the dichotomies. In the thinking and feeling component, though, when you have people of the opposite pairings, one of the things that ends up becoming really downright confusing and sometimes a projection of ill intent onto each other, if one person is insisting on the importance of something that the other person cannot see, and it will feel like the other, like if you're the person who is like, no, this is super important, I'm pointing at everything that indicates how important this thing is, and the other person's just like, I just don't understand why this is that big of a deal to you, I just don't get it, that can feel like your spouse or mate is being deliberately obtuse, or that they're not trying to understand your perspective, or they're not trying to meet you halfway. If they can't understand how important this thing is to you, maybe they don't understand you at all. There are so many ways to project ill intent onto your mate around this topic. And it's one, I think, that because there's so many stereotypes around it, then what ends up happening is it's like, well, that's just men. That's men for you. Or that's just how women are. That's just women. And there's this sense of like, never the twain shall meet. Like there's nothing you can do about it. That's just, you know, that's men. But then the problem is that if you're in like a heterosexual relationship where there's one man and one woman, there's a lot of marginalizing that happens to the other person because they get put into this box. Like that's, people talk about personality types being stereotypes that put you in a box. I think the way we see each other as men and women is probably one of the most egregious ways that we put each other in a box. Like in a really, like, for some reason, society's totally fine with this, but it's like one of the worst ways we do it.
Well, it's probably the most ancient way of categorizing us as humans. That's probably why we're okay with it. It's like so primal to us.
And there's probably some versions of this in a same-sex relationship as well. There's probably some way to, you know, to kind of figure out, like we're always so good at figuring out ways to marginalize each other. But oftentimes sometimes it has to do with gender, but most of the time it doesn't. It has to do with these components and what are the things that are intrinsically important to you based on your decision-making process, whether or not you're a thinker or a feeler, and then even what kind of thinker and what kind of feeler you are. So it's really easy for us to, you know, just go, oh, I guess they'll just never understand. But the reality is that if we really get how the other person evaluates things, again, they're probably handling a bunch of stuff that we're not even seeing that they're handling. And oftentimes they can be the voice of reason when we're in a situation when the world demands of us something that we are not equipped to give. And I've seen this many times in our relationship. if something is making me feel a really unpleasant emotion, it is so easy for me to go, that's not an emotion I want to feel. And I just shut it away. It just goes on a shelf in a room and I shut the door and I lock it. And I'm like, that's not an emotion I'm going to be feeling. But it doesn't mean that the emotion actually went away. It just means that I have lots of great strategies for ignoring and neglecting it. And one of the things that you've done is you've helped me access emotions that are unpleasant and process them. So I'm a lot cleaner. Like I have a lot more genuine positivity in my life, not like a neglecting the negative stuff positivity, not like a fake or synthesized version. And I know that in moments when you get all riled up about something, sometimes all you need is just a clarity of thought. You just need to talk through it and have somebody bring, like, quote unquote, the voice of reason.
Yeah.
Not that you're not a reasonable person and not that I'm like completely emotionally retarded, but you and I provide a service for each other that in those moments, I'm deeply appreciative of what you provide in the relationship. And sometimes, like, if we don't understand where the other person is coming from, it's really easy to forget all those other moments when you've provided such an amazing service for me in the moment where I'm like, well, you should just get it. You should just get why this is super important. And we've had fights over that where something was all of a sudden super important to me. You're like, I don't understand why that's important to you. And then eventually you go, well, you know what? It is super important, so I'm just going to honor that. And I think I've done the same for you.
Oh, yeah.
In moments where I don't understand why something is super important, I just go, you know what? I'm going to honor that because I don't get it, but I don't have to.
Well, I think for feelers, every time that we are emotional, anytime I'm serious about something or something's important to me, the best way for me to express that is with emotion. And sometimes, especially if it's a heightened experience, let's say we're in the middle of a conflict, I don't get emotionally crazy or erratic. I'm not usually like screaming or ranting or raving or emoting crazy. It's just that I have access. I'm coming from an emotionally centric place, and you can feel that emotion coming. And because you're a thinker, if you try to play on that sandbox, that's going to cause you to not show up as your best self. So you will distance yourself from my emotion, and I'll feel as if you're turning off and you're getting very cold, but that's actually you doing me a service because you're showing up as your best self, getting very present to your thought process. And it takes me as a feeler many years of experience with this to rest into, oh, she's not shutting herself off. The lack of emotion is actually her taking this just as serious as my emotion being amped up. And this, and the reverse is true too. If you come and you say something rational and all of a sudden I'm responding in an emotional way, and you go, oh man, he's getting triggered and emotional around this. No, it's me taking it serious and showing up at the table. Now, if I'm emoting badly, obviously that's one thing. Or if you're being really harsh, that's one thing. But I think both of us have gotten this dance down with each other as a thinker and feeler in the dynamic that we understand that that's our strength. And I think we respect that. So I think that's the thing you need to watch out for. If you're a feeler with a thinker or a thinker with a feeler, just know that that's their sandbox they play in. It's not them either getting erratic and emotional for no reason or turning off and getting cold for no reason. If they're doing that, and again, if you're in a healthy relationship and things are going well, that's usually a sign of them getting into their strength so they can show up as their best self for you. I think that's really important to remember. That's how they're wired, and they're coming to the table giving their gifts to you in the best way they know how. They're taking it serious.
I think this particular dichotomy is the one where people have to be very careful not to use their strengths as weapons against each other.
Yeah.
Because I have been in relationships with feelers that know how to play me like a fiddle.
Yeah.
They just know. Because my feeling process is not very... Like, I just don't expect people to hit me there. I know that ENTPs can be a bit emotionally manipulative if they want to be, but I've never really gone to that place. Like, emotional manipulation has never been interesting to me. And I was blind to it for a long time. And some feelers, particularly people who use introverted feeling or what we call authenticity, can be quite persuasive, especially if they're manipulating me with positive emotions, which sounds weird, but I've had that happen. So... I see how it happens to me. So I'm assuming that thinkers, in some ways, their emotions can get really kind of hijacked by a feeler if the feeler is up to no good. And on the other side of the coin, I think thinkers can use their abilities like a hammer as well, or they can use it in a weaponized way usually
marginalizing, usually.
Yeah, marginalizing or being condescending or winning every argument by, you know, outreasoning the other person because you're always thinking those terms and assuming that's the thing that'll win the argument or that's the most important component, which it sometimes isn't. But this is the one place that if you're in a relationship with somebody of the opposite dichotomy, really be careful not to utilize it as a weapon against the other person. Try to always use it as a tool for understanding, if at all possible. I mean, fights happen. We're going to weaponize sometimes. It's the reality of the situation. But do your best to observe try to observe what it's happening and try to mitigate that as much as possible.
I think if you're healthy, though, this can be a beautiful, wonderful relationship. One of you is a thinker. One of you is a feeler. And I think that if you can come to terms with how the dynamic plays out, I think it can be a wonderful polarity. And it creates attraction. It creates a lot of, you know, maybe sexual tension or energy there. It's a really interesting dynamic. And I think it can be really beautiful and wonderful in relationship. Now, two feelers together, you know, the first inkling would be, wow, feelers together, that's going to be the warm, fuzzy blanket that is feeling, getting in relationship. It's going to be perfect. I would say it can be a beautiful, wonderful relationship if you're with another feeler. However, I've noticed that when feelers are in relationship, sometimes they can actually be very harsh with each other. And one of the reasons I think is because it's like, well, you know how it is. You're a feeler. I don't have to be extra careful to make sure I'm not being harsh sometimes. And I think this comes through. An example of this is not in a romantic relationship, but in my family, for example, when my parents and I, or my brother and I, we're all feelers and we text back and forth, you're like, man, you guys are so harsh in text. Like, you feelers are just so aggressive and direct with your text messages. You don't give any context. You just give data out, like, straight up. I feel so caustic. And I'm like, really? None of us have that experience. It's kind of, we're all feelers. We're just assuming there's not prickliness there, I think, or something, or maybe we're cool with being more direct in that way. And when you send messages, for example, text messages to my family, you're very careful to put smiley faces and all the different things to let them know that that's the feeling you're trying to convey through the text. And I'm sure that that's probably a better approach no matter who you're texting messaging wise, because it can always be misinterpreted via text. But I can see that feelers from the outside might look more harsh to each other. Two feelers in a relationship, people might, man, you guys are harsh with each other. What is going on there? And they're like, well, we're not harsh. This is just our dynamic. This is just how we get information back and forth. Weirdly enough, you'd think that it was this warm, soft, fuzzy place. But I think that can actually happen often.
That's interesting. That is really different than what I would have expected. I would say that my assumption, of course, this is more of the stereotype, is that two feelers together would be more dramatic.
I think, like, that can happen too.
Yeah, they just love the drama of the emotion. So they might create situations that allow them to have the heightened emotion, even if it's like a negative heightened emotion. So not getting too much into the drama pool would be, I think that would be probably the stereotypical response, but I find it interesting that you're saying, and also they can be kind of harsh with each other, assuming that the other person's okay.
Yeah, and I don't, again, this is broad brush.
Yeah, of course.
We don't know you listening right now. If you're in a relationship with a feeler and you're like, it's wonderful, we're never harsh, it's so pleasant. I'm not saying all the time. I'm just saying that could be a potential relationship dynamic. And I think that could cause some resentment and conflict depending on how intense or not intense that is.
Yeah. I mean, it's interesting because you're saying that from the perspective of a feeler and you've been in relationships with other feelers. So that's something I wouldn't have expected, but that's interesting. So let's talk about two thinkers in a relationship. And I've been in a relationship with another thinker. And I think, at least from my experience, now your relationship or experience may vary, but what I observed was that when both of us had thought through something thoroughly and had used all our mental faculties, if we came to different conclusions, there was no way that we were going to back down. I saw that in the fights that we had, we would try to out-argue each other. And our fights were probably it probably didn't look very emotional from the outside, but I remember moments when both of us, like, our blood was boiling and it probably looked very steady and very even keeled, but I'm like, both of us had daggers in our eyes because we were just so certain that we knew the right thing. Now that's probably a lot of relationships, actually, this insistence that we know the right thing or the right way to go about stuff. But I saw that from the thinker to thinker perspective, it became like a legit battle, like a real authentic, I was going to convince the other person of this. And I'm sure if you do have a thinker to thinker relationship, one of the ways to transcend and become like a really healthy relationship is the ability to back down and not have to prove your point and not have to prove the extraordinary rationality of your situation. Now, of course, we were both intuitive thinkers in the relationship, so that might flavor, like, change the flavor a little bit as well. But I do think that when two thinkers in a relationship, there's just this insistence that you're seeing more than the other person is, and it's very difficult to back down. Whereas I don't see that happening as much in thinker-feeler relationships or feeler-to-feeler relationships. There might still be that same flavor to it, but it, or that same, you know, situation, but it the flavor has changed. And I think there's a softness that a feeler will bring to the relationship, and I mean that in the best way possible. It's this sense of like, do I want to be happy or do I want to be right? And sometimes a feeler will bring a sense of, why don't we just get along? Maybe we should just do that instead of insisting on our perspective.
Yeah, I think what you're tapping into here is when thinkers are in relationship with each other, thinkers have a tendency to be in a conceptual reality. So it's about concepts and about logic. And most times in relationship, nothing is about logic and concepts. It's always about energy and emotion. And feelers are tapped more into the energetic reality of the situation. So two thinkers, they're in conceptual reality. There's still a ton of emotions under the surface, but they're up in the head and the energy shut down. And it's like, I've got to solve this logically with this person. So I'm just going to give them the logic. And of course, they're going to understand this position. I mean, they're logical too. And most times, 9 times out of 10, we can get to some type of consensus around our logic. If you're in a, again, healthy, generally healthy relationship, most times you're like, yeah, I can see that perspective. But it's those times when you're at odds and you're frustrated and having conflict, it's almost impossible to solve those challenges in conceptual reality when you're up inside your head. You have to be in energetic or present reality. And you got to get into the energy and emotion of the situation. And that's very challenging, especially as two thinkers are trying to out-logic each other. Where does the energetic reality come from? Because it's not like there's a feeler there to bring that to the table to try to set the tone. So I think that's one of the biggest challenges I can see between two thinkers.
That was beautifully expressed.
Thank you.
Yeah, no, that was beautiful. That's exactly it. And a lot of times it's about the connection, not just insisting upon your perspective. So getting to the connection piece means getting to a more present, like you said, heart space. And so for thinkers, the challenge will be to remember to bring it back to the heart, because the relationship is all about, I mean, for the most part, our relationships are heart connections. So remembering to bring that element back in. So let's go to the final dichotomy. So that would be judger perceiver. And I think this is a battlefield between judgers and perceivers that is super obvious from the outside, I believe.
Yeah.
Judgers like their organization in the outside world, and perceivers like their freedom in the outside world. And so most of these are kind of stereotypical arguments about, like, you know, why are you misplacing everything? We have a place where the scissors go. Why do you keep moving the scissors? Like, the scissors go in that drawer. Like, that makes sense, right? To the judger, a place for everything and everything in its place. And to a perceiver, that's not as interesting. And so, not to say that every judger is meticulously clean and organized, and not to say that every perceiver is some sort of like Tasmanian devil wreck that's going from room to room. Those would be stereotypes that would not be accurate. And yet there is a sense of truth to it, usually as it plays out in the real world. There's also another component that judgers like to know what's coming next. They like to be able to be prepared and planned for it. Whereas perceivers enjoy a more improvisational and spontaneous lifestyle if they can get away with it. And so there may be some sense of the perceiver doing things that are spontaneous that really destabilize the judger. It could be in, there's lots of different contexts for it. Some of the more stereotypical ones are spending too much money because I just loved that thing. And the judge's like, yeah, but the bean counting. So that's more of a stereotypical one. Another piece of it is that the perceiver might feel like some of their spontaneity is being repressed because the judger needs everything to be kind of mapped out and lined up. And the more judger-like the judger is, the more they're going to insist on that. And the more perceiver-like the perceiver is, the more they're going to go the opposite direction. So it's a matter of creating an environment where both people get their needs met, and also creating an environment where you can meet in the middle. Like recognizing that both these things, just like with all of the dichotomies, both of these things are perfectly valid. They're 100% authentic to the people who are wired this way. There's nothing wrong. There's no value statement here. There's just a matter of creating an environment that is conducive to both people. And you don't always have to have it your way. Like, as a perceiver, you can figure out how to not have a floor drobe and have all of your, like, as soon as you take off your clothes, just toss them on the end of the bed or on a chair or whatever. You can learn to hang your clothes up, just like a judger can learn to live with just a little bit of chaos and uncertainty and maybe not always know what's coming up next, because the perceiver needs to have some spontaneity in their life. So figure out the ways in your lifestyles where you can compromise. Figure out, like, as a judger, what are the components that are super important to you? Is it that you really don't care if the house is meticulously clean, you just need to have it organized? And that's the thing that's important to you? So communicate that. Like, that's the piece. I just need to know where everything is. I need to have the visual clutter removed. That's the thing that's super important to me. Whereas the perceiver might go, hey, I can handle all that, but what I really need is I just need to know that you'll jump in the car and go to a movie with me last minute. Or I just need to know that you'll, like, you know, you'll say yes if I'm like, hey, let's open up a bottle of wine tonight and just drink it. And, like, you know, like, I know we had, like, stuff we were supposed to do tonight, but let's just, you know, play hooky and go do something else. What are the things that are super important to you? What are the ways in which your judgerness comes out and needs to feel expressed authentically? And what are the ways that your perceiverness needs to come out and be expressed authentically? And it will be different depending upon the person. But be clear about those things and communicate them to the other person.
And two judgers together obviously have similar organization styles, obviously. And that can be a joy in relationship. That can be great. But I think one of the things that can happen, and I actually have relatives that, like, they're so routinized, they're so disciplined around their schedule. They're both judgers. They're both IJs, introverted judgers, that they have zero wiggle room. Like, if I fly into town, they won't come pick anybody up at the airport because they're so rigid on the schedule they have, and they can never bend from it. And so both of them together in relationship are reinforcing this. And their house is always organized. They're always on schedule. Things are always done. They go to bed at like 8 o'clock at night and get up early in the morning. Like, their lives are like running like clockwork, and it works great for the two of them. And, you know, there's some conflict that can always arise, you know, in that directly. But I think the conflict with them is from them and the outside world. Like, the conflicts between the couple themselves and how everyone else responds to them, because they're a self-reinforcing dynamic there. Now, that I think that's an extreme example. If you're with another judger, it probably isn't to the degree where you're turning yourself off from people in the outside world just because you're so organized. But I think that's one of the dangers, is if you're with a judger, you guys can reinforce each other to the degree where you don't have any spontaneity. And then the conflict can arise from boredom, or again, getting into a rut or a routine to the degree where you're like, well, this, I'm starting to lose my attraction for this person, or even attraction for life, because I'm just, everything is so routinized and there's no excitement or newness at all.
Yeah. And you might kind of like that to some extent.
I think at first, but I can't imagine that being sustainable.
Yeah. Over time, again, it's that bucket list, right?
Well, yeah. And these relatives, you know, in recent years made some really quick decisions, I think, because of it. I think because they've lived such a templatized, scheduled and structured life. One day they said, hey, we're going to move to another state. And within like a couple weeks, their entire house was sold, packed up, and they were gone.
And I don't think it was a good move.
I don't know. I haven't really determined whether that was a good decision or not, but it seemed rash, and it seemed like it just, they almost acted out of, they needed something exciting to happen after years of just meticulous schedule keeping.
You're right. To say it wasn't a good move is a rash judgment, but I will say that it seems as if they have some regrets around it.
I do pick that up. I sense that a little bit.
Yeah.
And I think that's just because they wanted to generate that excitement that they've been missing. Mm-hmm. And then maybe they made potentially a rash decision that could be a bad decision, could be a good decision, but certainly was a quick decision, especially for them and how they usually are so routinized. So I think that can be a source of conflict, or at least, you know, trouble might emerge from that depending on the dynamic at play.
Yeah. And you and I are both perceivers, so we can speak to the perceiver-perceiver relationship.
Oh, the darkness.
Oh, the darkness. Now, what's nice about a perceiver-to-perceiver relationship is that we love each other's spontaneity. Like, we're like,
yeah,
let's just go do this cool, fun thing. Yeah, let's go do it. But I will say that after 5 years of living in the house that we live in, there are still many things that are not organized at all. It just always gets put to the back burner. Like, and so there's these sort of perpetually open loops in our lives that sometimes cause stress and sometimes we don't care. And then sometimes they cause stress and then sometimes we don't care. And so I think that there's some danger, or not danger, but some something to remember that two perceivers together may have they might unconsciously create a lot of fires for themselves to put out. You and I have always struggled to make sure that we're ahead of the game, not always playing catch up. And so one of the things we've done in our business is hire a bunch of judges to keep us accountable. We were like, okay, let's make sure that we surround ourselves by judges, because we know how you and I both know how we operate. I mean, we were great at entrepreneurship, and now that the business is moving into like a legit sort of business, like not so much that starving artist entrepreneur space, but actually like, okay, so now we like have a couple employees and now we're actually like doing this thing, and you and I both have this sense of restlessness. Yeah. I can feel it. But knowing that we're both perceivers helps a lot, because then we can help mitigate some of that. But there can be some danger in both being perceivers and having just like a slight sense of irresponsibility that is intentional. It's like intentional irresponsibility. And I think going back to the judger-perceiver relationship, just like with the sensor-intuitive relationship, there's a lot of stuff that the other person is bringing that you don't really recognize until it's not there. Like I can feel the lack of a judger in our relationship.
Yeah, I can too.
Yeah, like I can feel, like I know that if I was with a judger, I probably wouldn't appreciate them. But since I'm not with a judger, I'm like, I can feel it. I can feel that you and I are both like, every once in a while, we're like, can you just be a judger for like 2 seconds? And the other person's like, no, because I'm not. So like, there's something to be said about really appreciating the other and what they bring to the situation. And of course, in that judger-perceiver relationship, the perceiver brings the fun and the joie de vivre and the spark of life, which is part of the attraction. So you and I have lots of joie de vivre and spark of life, and we have a lot of like, oh, who's going to take care of this? I don't want to do it hot potato moments too. But I think we have acknowledged this and created systems around us, or tried to create systems that help, you know, kind of neuter some of that damage.
Yeah, sometimes we have to burn more energy because, you know, the ball gets dropped or whatever. And I think just like two judges together, sometimes the conflict isn't between themselves. I think between you and me, it's a very similar pattern. It's not like we're in conflict because we're two perceivers. But when my son Sawyer comes to stay with us on weekends, he's an ESTJ, and both my oldest son Gunner and our daughter Piper are both perceivers as well. So poor Sawyer, again, the only judger in the house. The challenge of us both being perceivers is it's just not on our radar to accommodate the steadiness and the predictability and the schedule that my son Sawyer would most likely like to have. So I think, I actually think for a double judger relationship or a double perceiver relationship, the conflict mostly, from my experience anecdotally looking at it, comes from outside of the relationship. The conflict is between the couple and a third entity, or a third whatever, you know, person, entity, business,
environment,
whatever it is. That seems to be the conflict point. And so I think that's where you're going to see conflict arise. It's not necessarily between each other. I mean, you can, if things get dropped and you're like, oh, I thought you were handling this. I thought you were handling this. And there's some frustration. But often I've noticed that our conflict around our perceiver nature comes from without, not from within.
I think that's a great way of stating it. And I think one of the things you in a relationship need to watch out for is to not turn on each other. When the stressor comes from the environment or from without, don't turn it into a make wrong for the other person in the relationship. I think that's a great, great point.
Yeah.
So we've talked a lot about relationship mixes with these dichotomies. Next week, we're going to talk about cognitive functions in relationships. But what we want to know is what's going on for yours. What's your relationship like? Are you doubled up on some of your dichotomies, or are you complete and total opposites? And what has been some of your observations? We'd love to hear from you. Please leave a comment at the bottom of this podcast on the Personality Hacker website and tell us what your experience has been.
You know, we don't have in the personal development starter kit. So when you take the test on our site and you come out, like I would come out ENFP basically, and I could invest in the ENFP starter kit. There's tons of free resources on personalityhacker.com. You don't have to get the starter kit. But if you do choose to get the starter kit, there's no direct, you're an ENFP and you're lined up with this person. But what we have created is about me guides to give to your lover or spouse that will help them understand your personality better. So we have created some resources there in that starter kit that will help facilitate the relationship. It doesn't matter who you're with. This guide tells them about you. And it just came to mind as you were mentioning this, that that's a resource that we have created that's in those starter kits that I think is very valuable for people. A lot of people have said that really has helped their marriages or their relationships because it's something they can give to their lover or spouse and they can look at it and go, oh, wow, I really get you now. I understand a lot about what's going on for you. If you want to join our community of like minds, I want you to go over to facebook.com/personalityhacker or twitter.com/personalityhack. Go ahead and like that page, join the community, start following us on Twitter. We want to have you engaged. You've been sitting here this week with us talking about relationships, talking about personality types and relationship, and we want your voice represented in the community. So come on over, do that now, put your headphones down, whatever, come over and join the community and be a part of the conversation with us. We really want to have you represented there.
If you enjoyed this podcast, you can subscribe to us on iTunes and various Android platforms. And if you'd leave us a rating and review, that helps us out a lot.
My name is Joel Mark Witt.
And I'm Antonia Dodge.
And we will talk with you on the next Personality Hacker podcast.